Is your weight problem caused by a chemical imbalance? If you've tried diet and exercise and have struggled to find lasting results, and you wonder quietly if maybe something else is going on, maybe it's your hormones, like a chemical imbalance, you're almost certainly right. It probably is. In fact, you might also have a nervous system imbalance, and you may even have a bacterial imbalance in your gut. These three bodies, our chemical body, our hormones, our electrical body, our nervous system, and our bacterial body in our gut, they work independently, but they also work synergistically to lay the groundwork for what might be energy balance, or in many cases, imbalance leading to weight gain. This is not the end-all story with weight gain, but it's such a huge problem and so often overlooked. I think it's worthy of taking a deeper dive and a deeper look, especially if you're struggling to lose weight. To illustrate this, I'll share with you a story about my friend from sixth grade named Anne. I was 12 years old and Anne sat next to me in homeroom, and Anne was really good at math and piano, and she also had obesity. She was quite large. She was quite a bit larger than me. All the other kids taunted her and bullied her. They called her Fat Anne. In typical junior high fashion, the cruelty never ends. She was Fat Anne in recess. She was Fat Anne in the lunchroom all day, every day. I remember specifically during PE class, we had a physical fitness test every semester, and we all had to get on the scale in front of all of our peers. It was pretty humiliating for everyone. But when Anne got on the scale, the PE teacher had a clipboard and he had a BMI scale, and he told Anne in front of everyone that she was in the obesity category and that she had 30 pounds of extra weight. Anne broke into tears. As you probably imagine, her tears turned into rage. And in her rage, she screamed at everyone, "You don't understand. I have a chemical imbalance." I wish the story had a happy ending, but it doesn't. No one took her seriously. All the students giggled. Even the PE teacher smirked. And the taunting and the bullying continued for the rest of the year. But this story stuck with me all these years later. And I'm sharing it with you now because at 12 years old, even though my chart said I was a healthy weight, I didn't know anything about calorie counting or weight loss. I wasn't on a special diet plan or anything like that. None of us were. We were 12 years old. So why was it that Anne had extra weight and I had normal weight and some of the kids were underweight? Why was there this huge disparity? Is it because Anne was lazy and gluttonous and lacked moral character? No, not anything that I could see. And this is not true for almost everyone who struggles with weight gain. The underlying issues are things you can't see. The motivators are so, so difficult to pin down. This is what we'll chat about today, how imbalance of our hormones, imbalance of our nervous system, and imbalance of our gut, or all three, can contribute or even cause weight gain. My name is Lucas, by the way. I'm a yoga teacher. I'm a nutritional coach. I have, for the past 20 years, really, really obsessed and researched and studied how to help people manage their weight, lose weight sustainably long-term. It's such a challenging thing and so rarely comes down to simply calorie counting. If that works for you, stop watching. This video is not for you. If you've struggled to lose weight traditional ways, this video hopefully will give you some insight from my experience. Please note, I'm not a doctor. I am not a dietitian. If you're living with obesity, this is a serious disease. Go get professional help. This is for educational purposes only. Let's start off talking about chemical imbalances, hormonal imbalances. We'll start off with three specific hormones. One, you've heard of for sure, which is insulin. Two, you've probably not heard of at all, which is ghrelin and leptin. Now, insulin has been studied and even medicated for over a century. Insulin is often referred to as the fat storage hormone. It helps to regulate blood glucose in the body, among other things. As you know, with diabetics, they have trouble either type 1 diabetics don't create enough insulin or any at all, and type 2 diabetics have the opposite problem. Their insulin is so high that they become insensitive to insulin and they need more and more to do the same job. What does any of that have to do with weight problems? Well, type 1 diabetics are often underweight and type 2 diabetics are often overweight. The hormonal difference can very often be a driver of weight gain, of adiposity. When it comes to ghrelin and leptin, ghrelin is your belly to brain hunger signaling, meaning your belly saying to your brain, "Lucas, eat more food." And leptin is your adipose tissue, your body fat to brain signaling hormone. And that is when Lucas's hips, the adipose tissue here, say, "Hey, we have enough energy storage or enough insulation. These are the adaptive purposes of body fat, by the way. No need to eat more. The reason I mention all three of these is because with my friend Anne in sixth grade, she very likely had one or more of these hormones out of whack. She almost certainly didn't go see an endocrinologist, a hormone specialist, to figure out how she might get these into balance. If you think that you might be struggling with runaway hunger, if you think you might be struggling with runaway adiposity, meaning you put on body fat really, really easily, or if you think you struggle or you know you struggle with blood glucose management, for sure, go see an endocrinologist. And when it comes to diet and exercise, traditional advice, of course those things are helpful, but also helpful are stress management, mental health, mental and emotional health, sleep. All of these things can play major, major factors in your energy balance equation. The next imbalance you might be struggling with that could affect your weight is a nervous system imbalance. Remember, your body has an electrical system and your autonomic nervous system governs so much of how your body allocates resources. If you think of the two main branches as your sympathetic, your fight or flight or your active arousal state, and then your parasympathetic, your rest and digest and renewal state, your body toggles between these throughout the day. And we have hyperarousal, like a jump out of the way from oncoming traffic state. We also have hyper down regulation of that stress response, like a way your body might feel after deep prayer or meditation or a period of deep rejuvenating sleep. That would be parasympathetic. But most of the time we're toggling somewhere in the Midlands here. However, many of us in our modern lifestyle, we tend to overemphasize our sympathetic arousal state with crisis news, with doom scrolling, with stress and anxiety and lack of sleep. This can put us into more of a sympathetic state and we start to lose balance, just like we've talked about before. Well, what does that matter in terms of weight gain? When we're in a hyperarousal state more than we should be, this can have downstream effects on our hormones coming back to our chemical body, specifically on the hormone cortisol, which is the stress hormone, which can help to release stored glucose in your liver and your muscles, which then can release insulin, the fat storage hormone we talked about before. And all of this can lead to inflammatory conditions that are really conducive to weight gain. So hyperarousal tells our body to resource allocate in ways that can set us up for weight gain, especially when we're not actually in physical danger. Our nervous system can play such a big role, but very rarely would someone go to see a meditation instructor or a breathing instructor or a religious or spiritual leader in terms of trying to manage a weight problem. But it could be that managing your nervous system, choose your preferred mind-body practice, might be a really great entry point towards creating a reverse domino effect and getting yourself back to balance. The third and final imbalance we'll discuss today in the context of weight gain and weight loss is your microbiome. You and me and just about everyone have 3 pounds of microbes here in our gut, mostly in our lower GI tract. Trillions of different microbes, most of which we have no idea what they do. But more and more, it's clear that these microbes influence everything from our mental health to our digestion, assimilation, our hunger, our satiety, and everything in between. There's way more that we need to learn than we know about now. But just to give you one example of some of the new research, in a study from 2020 published in the British Journal of Medicine titled Microbial Dysbiosis-Induced Obesity, so obesity caused by dysbiosis of the gut, researchers found that there's a clear correlation between inflammation, gut dysbiosis, and obesity, and a clear correlation between two specific microbes, one called Firmicutes and the other called Bacteroides, and the ratio of these two bacteria were correlated with obesity as well. Now, again, this is just one study and this is still a growing body of evidence, but you almost never hear of someone with a weight problem going to see a gastroenterologist, a gut health doctor, when that might be a very, very smart choice. So what do we do with all this information, knowing that our weight problem might be caused by underlying imbalances of hormones, of our nervous system, of our bacteria? Let's come back to the story of Anne, and I'll share with you what I think might have been a better outcome for Anne in the long term. No idea where she's ended up now, but it would have been really, really helpful if she went to see a hormone specialist, an endocrinologist. it probably would have been a great idea for her to go see a mental health professional or someone to help her manage her mind and her body, whether that was a spiritual teacher, a meditation teacher, a yoga class, or a talk therapist. When it comes to her gut health, it probably would have been helpful to go see an endocrinologist just to rule out any gut dysbiosis issues that might have been contributing or causal. Do diet and exercise matter? Of course they do. But if you're doing diet and you're doing exercise and it isn't working, what you need to understand is that balance, whether it's in our body, whether it's in politics, whether it's in nature, is extremely rare. Most things trend towards imbalance. And just to set the stage, when Ann and I ate lunch together, which we did back in sixth grade, most of the days we would eat tater tots or chicken fried steak or some soggy pizza at our public school cafeteria. And the difference between Ann's body and my body really boils down to about 14 tater tots per day, expanded out over a year. Now, was Ann actually eating 14 more tater tots than me? I doubt it. I don't think that's how it actually worked. But I just want you to understand how delicate this balance is. The difference between my normal BMI and her obesity BMI really comes down to 14 tater tots. And to think that all she needed to do was to throw a couple of tater tots in the garbage, that's a simplistic view of what was going on. When we look at whole person health and holistic weight loss, you might find better results pulling other levers such as sleep or stress management or gut health or some of the things that are less obvious sometimes can have a cascading positive effect that can spur forward or even reverse the weight problem you might be experiencing. Hope you find that helpful. As I mentioned before, if you find this video useful, I'd love it if you hit subscribe down below. I have a program called YOGABODY Daily. It's not a weight loss program, but it is a program about living your best life in the second half. And to that end, we do strength and stretching and steps every day. Positive, supportive group of people just like you all around the world. You can learn more about that at yogabody.com. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you in the next video.